Welcome to the Engineer Innovation Podcast, powered by SimCenter. This podcast is a show by engineers, for engineers, in which we explore how engineering simulation and test are contributing to a healthier, happier, and more sustainable future.
So this is one of a series of interviews I conducted at this year's Realize Life conference in Munich. And the intention was that I locked myself in a room with 20 different engineers and talked to them about how they're using simulation and test at the cutting edge of industry. In this episode, I talked to the CEO of Belgian startup Forcebit, who are developing a smartwatch for machines. And I started off the interview by asking my guest to introduce himself.
Okay. So my name is Jan Croes. I recently founded a startup. It's called Forcebit. And our aim is to make measurements easy for the machine industry. So basically what we designed is a smartwatch which you put around the shaft of a vehicle on a machine and tells the most important characteristics related to its health and performance. And for a machine or a vehicle, that means the torsional loads, bending loads, and rotational vibrations.
And so most of the people listening to this now will be familiar with putting strain gauges onto equipment. So how is what you're doing different than just sticking strain gauges onto a shaft and measuring torsion that way?
So the thing is, what our motto is, we are fast, easy, and reliable. And sticking strain gauges on a shaft, it's not fast, it's not easy, and it's not reliable. Because what you have to do is you have to build up a sensor from scratch onto a shaft in an environment that is oily, that is messy, there is no room. And what you have to do is you have to completely prepare your shaft, you have to mount strain gauges, you have to wire stuff, you have to balance it, you have to put duct tape around it, and you have to pray that things don't fly off, because that happens more than often. And what we do, we have a bracelet, which you put around the shaft, and that gives you this torque and bending straight away without all the hassle that you normally have with putting on strain gauge.
So literally, it's like a smartwatch for your. That's how you're describing as well,
yes,
which is a
yeah.
really clever analogy. And how does the technology work inside your device, if it's not a commercial secret, of course?
We patented the part of the solution. So all the hardware, which is visible, I don't mind telling it. So what we basically make is we make a weak spring that we put around the shaft, and that takes over the deformation of the shaft. And because the spring is so weak, the shaft doesn't really feel that there is extra part on it. It's really light, it's really flexible, so it doesn't change the system dynamics at all. And this part, which we put on top of the shaft, it will deform along with the shaft, and this deformation is something that we're measuring. And that deformation is representative for the torque and the bending moments inside of the shaft.
So a single device measures all those things as well. You're not just measuring torque, you're measuring torque, bending moment.
Yeah, and then rotational displacement, velocity, and acceleration.
Does the device come, or will it come in different sizes? Will you have for different shaft diameters, or is it adjustable?
That's the thing also. If you're making a weak spring, putting around the shaft, it needs to, of course, comply with the diameter of the shaft. Of course, we know that and not every shaft is perfectly round. There is some variation in the diameter of a few tenths because of production tolerances. We can all compensate for those kind of things, but a shaft of 30 millimeters, you fit a sensor around it. It can be slightly smaller, slightly bigger, but still it fits within a really narrow area. That's something important to mention.
So your device is collecting data. How do your customers use that data?
So we're collecting the data, really the high throughput data. We're not doing any feature extraction up front. We're collecting the high throughput data, and that one directly goes to the customer. And then the customer, what does he do? He evaluates the durability with it, he evaluates energy efficiency it, and he evaluates performance.
And so you're intending this to be used inside a lab for kind of testing or on final kind of vehicles as well?
It's really meant vehicles and machines that are in the prototyping phase, having the first field tests, to really understand what's going on and to how to further improve it. Also in the framework of troubleshooting, if you spot that some weird vibrations are popping up, or if your production process is not exactly as you envisioned it and some weird orders are happening or some things are breaking down, it's the quick tool to assess what's going wrong and how to improve it.
And so basically you use engineering simulation, I guess using SimCenter, to analyze and to perfect this device. How have you used simulation in the design of, is it Forcebit, it's called, isn't it?
Yeah. So what we exploited the most is the finite element package. So first the CAD design, the CA design. So first we need a design that is very parametric so that we understand how does it size with the shaft diameter. How do we account for small curvatures? How do you account for thickness of certain parts? Because we need to assess the durability of the sensor. We need to optimize the sensitivity of the sensor. And we need to optimize the contact of the sensor onto the shaft. So there's a lot of nonlinear finite element analysis on there to make sure that this contact is just right. We know that there is slip, but we need to contain this slip. We know that there will be, of course, some small deformations when you are clamping the part. We need to analyze bolt pretension. And all these things, we exploit SimCenter for it to ensure that we're really getting an optimal design.
And who's doing the simulation? Are you doing the simulation yourself?
Yeah.
If you're a CEO, and you're also getting your hands dirty. And so who's your colleague who works with you? What's his name? What her name?
Yeah, he's called Peter, and he has a background in business economics and law.
So he's not much help with the simulation part. You're doing all the dirty handheld stuff as well. So you have a full understanding of your project at the moment, your product as well. That's really impressive. So in terms of your customers, people who are the eventual customers for this product, what benefits do you think they can get from better understanding how their devices are performing on the testbed? So having a better understanding of what the torques are, what the bending moments, what is the payoff for those guys, do you think?
Well, we noticed that a lot of companies still tend to oversize their products. We also noticed that a testing campaign quickly gets really, really expensive. And then they have to make a compromise with what they want and what they can afford within a certain time frame. And because we noticed in testing, a big bottleneck is the time planned for the testing campaign. So you need to make sure the testing space is available. You need to make sure the machine or the vehicle is available. You need to make sure that all the technicians are available to instrument the machine. And that really makes sure that there's very high time to do this. What we mainly do is we shorten the cycle a lot. So you can measure much more, shorter time frame, get more value, and keep on feeding this digital twin that you are developing with all these SimCenter.
And so also reducing the amount of over-engineering because, you know, you understand your product better means you can use less material, less energy. And so it's actually a way of, you know, designing more sustainable products as well, I guess.
Yeah, indeed. Because, the more you can really understand what the loadings are inside your machine, the less likely you're going to make it more robust than actually needed. And making things smaller because you can, because you're not oversizing anymore, you can make things faster. Making things faster means you produce more per hour, and the whole cycle gets more energy efficient.
And so you describe yourself as a startup. How far along the startup process? So have you gone to market yet with this, or is it still a prototype?
So I started incubating the product while I was in university, noticing that when we're working with the street, that they tended to say, like I advised them, say, look, it's really important that you need to do the measurements on these particular places because we may build a simulation model for them. And then they said, just do more simulations because they were just, it's such a hassle to actually perform it. So I started developing the product. That took me over 4 years to get a prototype that is good enough, that demonstrates the concept. And then last year, somewhere in October, we started up the company. Then we burned quite a bit of money to get this problem market ready. And now we are really, you cannot see it, but it's really this close. So it's like 1 month, maximum two. And then we have the pilot cases with our first customer.
That's exciting. So thank you for coming to Realize Live to tell your story when clearly you're at a critical time for the company. But it's good to get the word out, isn't it, as well? And hopefully we can do that as well. It also seems to me that this is just a great time for this sort of technology. We talk, you know, at this point, Realize Live, you'll hear people talk about digitization. But, you know, we live in a world, like as you say, where it's difficult to measure the torsion on the shaft, which, you know, in engineering school, that's one of the first things you do. Yeah. And you think it's one of the problems that's already been solved. So having this capability to more easily model those things or measure those things, I think it's a really critical time. And I would imagine that obviously your core business model is in product development and trying to understand new products. But there must be loads of old products, you know, existing machinery that's in operation today where we don't have a good understanding of how it works. And so that's surely another market as well, isn't it?
Yeah, indeed. So in the existing portfolio of machineries that are already out there, we already know a lot of them are over damaged. We also know that refurbishment is becoming more and more popular every time. And also that the investment of a new machine is also getting a lot bigger. And then analyzing which parts, which motors are oversized, which subsystems are overcharged, that it can help you if you're refurbishing it instead of, we'll use a new gearbox and we'll change a different motor. That will help us to assess what are the loads on the system. And then if we make a design change, what is the best choice to make?
Yeah, and I also think there's lots of opportunity. Again, you're manufacturing a device, but for people to use the device as part of digital twins as well. So we talk a lot about you obviously your business is based around the difficulty of putting sensors on equipment. Yeah, you're making it much easier, but you can't have sensors everywhere. So combining simulations, which you've already done, you know, of the shaft with the sensors that you're giving gives people the ability to predict not only what's going on where you put your Forcebit smartwatch on the shaft, but across the whole shaft. You have that information. And that's a critical part of this whole digital twin story, is having access to good sensors, reliable sensors. I think that's a really impressive and exciting development.
That's also the main reason why I didn't start my career as a testing engineer. I built a lot of models of SimCenter AimSim, and I realized it's super nice and gives you a lot of power to design what-if scenarios. What happens if I boost up the speed? What happens if I change the subsystem? But then we also noticed that there were some parameters that are quite uncertain, and that changes the conclusions. And that made me realize there is really a need to make this connection with experimental data, because the digital twin is only as powerful if it really complies with reality.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's the issue, isn't it? The whole issue with, so we can talk about digital twins, but they're about generating huge amount of data, but you have to be able to trust the data, because otherwise, you know, we talk about machine learning, you'll hear a lot about this week, about artificial intelligence, but if that data isn't good, or from simulations which are not good enough, then the results, you're training an algorithm to do something using the wrong data, and that's not impressive either as well. So I think you have it sounds like a very exciting product, and one which I'm sure will be very successful as well.
I hope so too. The signs of the market are good. We know that there are people waiting for it. I think it's important to put next to all the artificial intelligence part, because sometimes artificial intelligence has led to the belief that merely the fact of having data will allow you to analyze everything. But it's really the type of data, it's really at the source, that the source of the data goes through your full analysis. And if the source is crap, it's garbage in, garbage out.
Yeah.
And that's, I think, there, exploiting simulations to understand where do I need to measure, and then measuring stuff that is actually physical, that tells you something about the energy efficiency, about performance, makes a big difference than saying, I combine a lot of things and I have a feature and I see that this feature does something, but I don't really understand what it means. I just have a cause effect, but I don't understand the relationship behind it. And that's also something that we want to try to do. We want to exploit the physics, that it will not only help for this particular design, but it will help also feeding your model that the next generation of design can also benefit from. Because you're really making sure your model is more representative of your reality. And if the physical model is representative, it's scalable for your next design.
I've been working in simulation for 30 years, and validation was always something you did maybe once or twice using idealized scenarios at the end of the process when it was probably too late to change it. So getting earlier, cheaper, more effective testing so you can validate your stress models or whatever models you need is incredible, and a big, big, big advance, I think, for the industry as well. So
the important thing is also after the facts, because most of the time a system integrator, it gets parts from different suppliers, and every component supplier has a certain set of specs. You don't really know whether they are correct or not. They're integrating things and it doesn't work. Who is to blame? The person who set the specs, or the person who designed the gearbox or the motor or whatever? And then doing a validation, a quick check. Does my torque, does my vibrations actually comply with the specs I put out for. That helps you to decide, well, yeah, where is the discrepancy? What do we need to change?
Yeah, I get that completely. So that solves a big problem. So you're based in Leuven still. Where would you intend to manufacture the product, or haven't you got that far yet?
Well, the nice thing now is that you can make your designs very detailed, very customized, and that, yeah, the internet just makes it very easily available. Additive manufacturing really lowers the threshold to making something. I can have really high-end multi-axial milling machines just by sending the drawings, and they come back to me within 2 weeks. So that really lowers the cost of the hardware I need. And then it's that what we only do is assembly.
Okay. And that's really important for a startup like yourself trying to get those first prototypes working is really expensive. And once you get through all the problems of doing that, then you're a big step forward, you're closer to going to market.
Software licenses are also very expensive. So if we can get some endorsements left and right.
I know. So you're the second. So I've interviewed about five people today already, and you're the second person who's come in here as a startup as well. And, you know, I know that last week I was talking to Jean-Claude, who is the boss of our division, who wants more examples of sustainable startups as well. Because, you know, that as you know, the name of our podcast is Engineer Innovation. And actually, you know, you don't get so much innovation from mature products and mature companies. It's guys like you who change things as well. So I think Siemens probably would want to be associated with your brand. And I think, you know, trying to have a chat with people like Jean-Claude Okunelele, who we can try to introduce you to. But yeah, we really, I mean, it was worth having that conversation with him as well, because we should be supporting startups like you, because of course we can sell you lots more software licenses when you're operating at scale as well. So there should be some sort of investment as well. So I think those are conversations worth having this week. I know that he's looking for examples of startups using our software to solve these problems and, you know, the sort of things that will help us solve the climate emergency ultimately, you know, and it's, I know that's not explicitly the role of your company, but there's loads of benefits in reducing energy, reducing costs, reducing materials. And I think that's a huge part of all this. And we don't get to solve these big problems about making lots of changes. And this is one of them as well. So it's really exciting as well. So is this the first time you've been to Realize Live?
Yeah, it's university at one of these Siemens events, but I think it had a different name then.
When was it? Where was it? Can you remember where was it?
It was somewhere in Germany.
So, okay, but did you get any value from attending the previous conference as well, do you think?
Yeah, for sure, because the thing is, it's a nice mix of having a lot of applications from customers, really seeing how they do that, how they struggle with things and how they solve that. So in that sense, it's quite inspiring. And also, it's a good idea to get a bit of a feeling on, yeah, what are the new stuff that is happening in software? Because it goes super fast and it starts from something. First, it was only system simulation. Now they're integrating more and more of the value chain. And it's also nice to see that even a mastodont like Siemens needs other competitors. The other, not other competitors, other partners to really ensure that they can offer the whole value. Even they cannot do everything.
I think that's the difference between Siemens and some of our competitors. We like to have an open ecosystem so that you can use whatever tools are best suited to you, because we can't cover it all. And it's interesting you said that in that little section there, you talked about seeing the struggles of other people, because I think that's really important as well. Is understanding that engineering, you know, doing new stuff, innovative stuff, it's not easy what we do. And the fact that everybody else struggles and having kind of understanding that and see how people solve their problems, I think is a really key point about situations like this. I think we all live in our own little simulation bubbles and don't see everybody else is having a hard time with it as well. So that's quite an interesting observation, I think.
Yeah, it's also good for your mental health. Because if you see people struggling, sometimes they get the belief that you are a simulation, you click a few buttons and you're there. It really takes a lot of effort to make something, you know, there's a lot of value. And then if you see that the other big players are also struggling, it's only natural. There is no quick fix. So that helps. And also, yeah, I also look at things that are a bit outside of my field sometimes to get a bit of inspired. And the broader your view is, it can only help, because you don't know what are the next steps are on your path or which field that
and
will be.
And hopefully you might find some potential customers here as well.
Yeah, indeed. If we would find some money, that would also be great.
Yeah, that's good, and to investors as well. So I think that's a really interesting application. The production, that's a story we'd like to follow. So, and I'm confident that you're going to be successful. So good. Thank you very much.
Good. Thanks a lot.
Thank you for listening to the Engineer Innovation Podcast, powered by SimCenter. If you enjoyed this episode, please leave a 5-star review and be sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode.
This episode of the Engineer Innovation Podcast is powered by SimCenter. Turn product complexity into a competitive advantage with SimCenter solutions that empower your engineering teams to push the boundaries, solve the toughest problems, and bring innovations to market faster.